Namo, Tasso, Bhagavato, Arahato, Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha.
Friends, 2.1 billion people, nearly 30%, one-third of the world's population are overweight. And obesity are the fifth leading risk cause for global death. At least 2.1 million adults die each year as a result of being overweight or obese. Half of the world's diabetes is caused by overweight. One quarter of all heart disease is caused by overweight. One tenth of all cancers is caused by overweight. Voracious desire for, and thus clinging to, sweet, sour, and bitter taste on the tongue causes overweight, obesity, bad appearance, self-depreciation, diabetes, heart attack, stroke, cancer, death, rebirth, and thus endlessly repeated aging, sickness, and death, and thus much suffering. Friends, desire for, and thus clinging to, sweet, sour, and bitter taste on the tongue causes much suffering, friends. Voracious desire for, and thus tenacious clinging to, soft, juicy, and crunchy touch on the tongue causes overweight, obesity, bad appearance, self-depreciation, diabetes, heart attack, stroke, cancer, death, rebirth, and thus endlessly repeated aging, sickness, and death, and thus much long-term suffering. Friends, desire for and cling to soft, juicy, and crunchy touch on the tongue causes much long-term suffering. Friends, any craving also for food causes suffering. So says the second noble truth. Craving causes suffering. So says the second noble truth of the Buddha. Craving always causes suffering. So says the second noble truth. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends, and welcome to yet another walk and talk in the jungle on various classical meditation objects within early Theravada Buddhism. I got several requests about this, to give this speech upon the experience of disgust in food. So here it comes. It's one of the classical objects, is sometimes translated to perception of the repulsiveness of nutriment. But I think this is a little convoluted translation. So the experience of disgust in food is a proper name, I think. So why is this a major issue also today, 2500 years after? This is because one-third of the world's population is overweight or obese. And overweight defined by a body mass index over 25. And your body mass index, you check your weight in kilos divided by your height in meters squared. And if this is under 25, then okay. If it's over 25, then you're overweight. If it's over 30, then you're obese. If you're over 35, then you're severely obese. If it's over 40, then you are dangerously fat. So 2.1 billion people out of the 7 billion people we are here on planet Earth now are overweight, fat among, in column, in common, straightforward language. And this means that they are at risk for getting diabetes. And when you get diabetes, but also just if you are being fat, you have an increased increase of heart attack and of strokes. And this accounts for most of the deaths. How many deaths a year? It's 2.8 million deaths a year. Almost 3 million people die from being overweight every year. It's far more than any wars kills, any accidents. So it's a major, major, major issue. So 45% die from this type 2 diabetes. And 25% from ischemic heart disease, that is heart attack. And the rest of them, stroke and certain cancers that are also more common found among people who are overweight. So it is seriously unhealthy to be fat. How come you become fat? So many people become fat in these ages. This is because there's so easy access to luxury food. If you can eat only potatoes and a half rotten, then you probably don't become overweight. But if you can eat ice cream and pork every day, burgers and fries fried in oil, and a large amount of sugar and highly processed carbohydrates that are absorbed directly into the blood and become converted to lipids, to fat, which cannot go the other way, cannot become converted to carbohydrates, and then they have to be stored on the buttocks, on the bum, and various other places as subcutaneous fat tissue. And this causes less resistance to insulin, and then you get type 2 diabetes, and then you have the whole thing growing. Type 2 diabetes is normally seen as an innocent disease, but they end up dying, being blind, having high blood pressure, no kidney function, in danger of kidney transplantation, and with several amputations of their toes and feet. Besides that, they have polyneuropathy, that is, means that they have a scratching, itching, very, very nasty feeling in the legs all the time. And impotence also, complete impotence. So it's by no means an innocent disease. It takes 20 years to get these late diabetic complications, but they are severe. It's not fun to become old, but it's especially not fun to become old if you have to go to dialysis or get a kidney transplant, and if you're blind, and if you have high blood pressure, and it's your legs are scratching, itching, tingling all the time. Then it's nasty. Huh? So because of this craving for this sweet taste, this desire, this lust, which causes continuous temptation to seek and acquire, buy new food items and then gulp them down. Because then you get taste, the pleasure of taste. And when you get the pleasure of taste, then there's a moment of peace for urge for taste. This peace is quelled, this urge for taste is quelled, and then the peace arrives. And right after the peace comes happiness, in normal language called satisfaction. This is last only a very short time, until when you take the spoon out the mouth and the taste of the ice cream, the intensity of the taste of the ice cream goes down, then you need to take a new taste, a new bite of ice cream. And then a new, until you become overweight, like these people you see here. They are now, the world records in overweight are over half a ton, over 500 kilos. There, beyond 300 kilos, you cannot move, you're lying in your bed. So there are somebody who feed them. And this also talks about the social psychopathology of these cases, that there's somebody who feeds them, despite their fat, then somebody who still feeds them, chocolate, nougat, ice cream, whatever, until they can, so they can grow even more from 300 kilos to 500 kilos. Then they cannot be transported in a normal ambulance. They have to use normal beds. They have to be transported. So it's a society problem, even when it's grotesque, as in these cases. Grotesque. This is a mental problem. It's not a physical problem. It's not a health issue. It becomes a health issue because there's this craving. And as we know from Buddhism, craving is the cause of suffering, which is very, very obvious in these extreme obesity cases, but also in the case of anyone who become little fat and unpleasant to look at, ugly, basically. Then they become less attractive as sexual objects. Then their spouse or their sexual partners won't have anything to do with them. Then they lose their sex pleasure. Then they, because of compensating for this lack of sex pleasure, then start to eat even more. Then they become even more fat and even more disgusting. And there's a large portion of self-hate connected with this being fat and ugly. So self-depreciation, self-hate then arise. In this milieu of looking yourself in the mirror every day and seeing an extreme obese person and experiencing yourself that you cannot say no to temptations, you cannot say no to sweets, to anything. Wherever you see food, then you go and seek food and buy food even though you don't need it. You actually need to starve at least 1 month. I did that in the jungle, it's easy. Just drink and water and eat a little bit of salt. A little bit of lemon juice can also do it. But a little bit of salt is good every day, and then only water for 1 month. Very healthy. And 1 week, once in a while, is also twice a year to take 1 week without food is also healthy. And it learns something about, you learn something very precious about craving, how this craving is guiding you around in the world, from this food stall to another food stall, to this supermarket, to that supermarket, to the butcher and back again, every day. And as a function of that, then you have to brush teeth and go to toilet, and however much you clean your teeth and clean your bum, then around the anal canal, the anus, then they will still be smelly and dirty. So it's important to induce this disgust. Because when you induce this disgust by seeing food, then the craving immediately ceases. Then you can control yourself. Then you don't need to take the food up with. It is only because the food is perceived as pleasure, as happiness, as a source to happiness. Therefore, one cannot say no to the temptation of taking even more food, even though one very well knows. Every obese person, overweight person, they know, of course, I don't need more food, at least I need less food. But since they identify and project happiness, pleasure into this food, then they don't see the suffering coming after by taking too much of this food. So it was very wise of the Buddha in this sense to set forth this meditation object, the experience of disgust in food, which we will expose right now. It's one of the kammatanas. Kamma means doing, tana, place or foundation. So it's kind of like working place, a mental working place. One of the 40 mental working places one should work. This is just disgust on food. Anything that is eaten, drunk, chewed and tasted, this regards as food. And there are 10 ways, 10 aspects where you consider this meditation. In going, seeking, using, secreting, receptacle, what is uncooked, undigested, and what is digested, fruit, outflow, and smearing. So the first is going. So you consider, instead of seeing food, then you say, I have to go to work, I have to go to the shop, I have to go to and stand in the queue in the supermarket, and how much pleasure is that? That is definitely not pleasure and happiness. That is very, very frustrating to have to go to work, to the supermarket and stand in the queue. For the monk then, I did that, went 5 years barefoot begging round, and then I got a lot of stone splinters in my feet because I have to walk 5-7 kilometers to get my food. And there it's easy to see that going is entailing suffering, going for food every morning. So you follow a path of streets full of filth, excrement of animals, all sorts of offensive smells, sewage, cloacation, robbers, murderers, and all kinds of bad weather. So the point is here to experience, to seek any kind of experience that is negative, that is painful, that is frustrating, that is suffering, regarded with this seeking of food. So you start with the food, when you should remember this this tendency, just start with where it comes from. It grows on the field, or it is if it's animal food, then it's running around inside a stable. And these are usually very dirty with excrement everywhere. So this is basically what you eat, something that comes from this. Either has come out of mud, or has come out of stables where they're full of excrement. Seeking, then one has to seek it where they serve food. And it can be food that was prepared yesterday. It can be food full of chemicals, even cancer-causing chemicals, and all kinds of preservatives and things that people put in food so it can be sold for 1 year after it's made. And there's no authorities, I know there's a doctor, that can overcome to check all these chemicals thoroughly to see whether they are healthy or whether they are unhealthy on the long run. Using. When one puts a hand in the food, the food in the hand and then in the mouth, then both the hand and the mouth becomes dirty. Huh? The teeth become smeared, the teeth become dirty, the tongue become dirty. The food become dirty because it's mixed with spittle, huh? With spit. So, and the original color and form of this delicious food, if you spit it out after you have chewed it, then usually you don't want to eat it again. And that's very illogical, because as long as it's inside the mouth, then you will big pleasure swallow it. However, if you take the same food lump, chewed up and mixed with spit, and then spit it out on the plate and look at it, then you would not eat it again. Huh? Dogs do that, but humans don't do that. Even more so, which it comes down into the stomach, then it basically becomes vomit. Huh? Then it's mixed with acid and slime that is in the ventricle, in the stomach, and then it becomes vomit. Looks like a dog vomit or human vomit colored. If you take that up and see vomit, how many wants to eat vomit? How many says, ah, this is delicious? It's still hot, you know. Huh? Why not? Why not? But nevertheless, that's what it becomes. It becomes vomit. So seeing the nice cake in the bakery, one should say, ah, this is, how does this cake become when it becomes vomit? How does this cake look when I have chewed it up? How does this cake look when it comes out the other end as excrement? Huh? Then you don't buy the cake. You don't need the cake anymore, suddenly. And then you're cured for this overeating and obesity and the unhappiness connected with this. So when then undigested, it becomes down in the stomach. Then it becomes fermented. All kinds of bacteria start to gobble it up, mainly colibacteria in the big intestine. And then there's a gas, so it's kind of like a bubbling cesspit down there. Intestinal fluid is usually brown, greenish black because of gall. Bile is mixed with it. After the acid comes in, then bile comes. And bile has this green, blackish color. So the fluid, which is almost as thin as water, just tinged with slime and a little bit foam, is intestinal fluid. It's around 10 liters for each meal. Then the fluid is reabsorbed again. But this is just green, brownish color. And this is kind of like bubbling and fermented down there to be digested. If you took this fluid, and I had taken this fluid because some surgical patients, they have this fluid running out the stomach in tubes, and then you have to, it runs down in a bottle, then you have to, as a young medical student, clean these bottles. And this can be very, very, very disgusting indeed, because it's very smelly in a particular way, especially if mixed with blood. It's called melena, and melena, you can ask all hospital workers that melena is the worst of the worst. It has an extremely repulsive smell and it's completely black. So excrement mixed with blood because of a bleeding inside the intestines. But nevertheless, if you take the email in a normal case, no blood, take this brown, green, bile-colored fluid, which you see here, and then say, is this something that I will eat like a soup? No, huh? But nevertheless, all food becomes to this greenish, brownish colors fluid. Later down, then this smelling and disgusting mix becomes excrement, which is kind of like a brown clay, or if diarrhea a little bit thinner, like a porridge. And then it comes out that have kind of like this very bad smell. So any kind of food comes that way. Then it comes out in the pot, and out of, on its way out in the pot, then it smears, especially if you have hairs down there in around the anal canal, then it smears the anal canal and the outside the skin there. So you have to use paper and a bidet flush to clean it. But even though, still it's dirty afterwards. And you have to wash it again and again and again and again. Never ending problem of this disgusting opening in the back. One thing also noticing is that people are usually not afraid of eating when they are together. This is a very social thing. But excrementing, which is a natural consequence of eating, this they do in private. This is a shame. So there's some shame connected with this eating physical food. So basically, this is considering all the disgusting aspects, the repulsive aspects. The more repulsive and disgusting they are, the better. Because that will reduce gradually this craving for food. And thereby the unhappiness connected with craving for food. If you don't get it, then you're unhappy, you don't get it. And if you get it, you become unhappy because you become fat and ugly and get type 2 diabetes, stroke and ischemia of the heart. And then heart attack and death, basically. You cannot eat anything when you're dead, like a pig or a fish on land. So there you have it. Disgusting food. Follow it from the source in all cases. And then see all the disgusting aspects from where it's grown, where it's produced. What it goes into it, whether it's chemicals or excrement, manure that is spread on the fields for the grass or the corn or potatoes to grow, or whether it's these animals that are tortured under completely insane circumstances in all kinds of various stalls and food factories, where chickens and pigs and lambs and cows, they suffer enormously, because we humans like the taste of meat. But the seeing the disgust, experiencing disgust with food, should be seen with all food items, because they're all the same. The funny thing is that as soon as it passes the lips, then what you appreciate as a beautiful, attractive, and in some cases exquisite, as soon as it's been chewed, then it's perceived as disgusting if it comes out again. But still is swallowed. It's swallowed and tasted with big gusto and delight. And there's some inconsistency, some lack of logical thinking there. When it's outside the body, then it's very delightful and attractive. And when it's inside the body, then it's disgusting. And also when it comes out in the other end as excrement in the toilet. Do this practice also. So one thing was, think about the disgusting aspect, because all kind of food, when you meet it in the advertisement on the streets or when other people eat during the social gatherings, anywhere, redirect mind from the attractive aspect to disgusting aspect. Then the craving goes down right there. Then you're free. Otherwise you're a slave. A slave of taste. This slavery will kill you. Not only from diabetes type 2 and a heart attack and obesity, but also because you come back, if you like food at the moment of dying, then you come back here for more food. Sometimes then as an animal. Sometimes as the same animal that you have eaten 20 billion times. Imagine being a chicken in a cage, huh? Or a pig. Difficult to experience happiness in that situation, huh? Very difficult. So downfall to the human state, or from the human state to the animal state, because of desire for food. Pigs, for example, they are very, very greedy for food. Dogs are also very, very greedy for food. This you see among many animals. They fight about the food until death. Dog will fight about a piece of rotten meat, basically. Like humans fight for rotten power and fame. I think this got... Nevertheless, I just say one thing. Look at your own excrement. People usually don't look at their excrement because they are feel repulsed by it. But this is free training. Free training. Huh? You just look down the toilet. Every time you excrement up a pass urine, look at it, smell at it, take it in fully, in big doses, how disgusting it is experienced as. Huh? Touch it with your hand. And then think about, this is coming. This is a consequence of food, of feeding. This happiness, this disgusting thing that comes out of my body, like spit. Huh? It's a consequence of my craving for food, which is connected with having a body. In Nibbana, you don't have a body. Then you don't need to feed. Then you don't need to go to the toilet. And you don't need to go to work to earn money to buy food. That's happiness. Not before is there any happiness whatsoever. Thank you for your clever attention, kind contribution, and time. And also, may you have a nice day. Over and out here from the forest, on Knuckles Mountain, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka, where everybody is welcome. And there is a meditation course in this and all the other 40 meditation objects, the 18th June 2018. If interested, please leave me an email. Namo. Tas. Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa. Whatever. Honorable and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. 27 minutes and 37 seconds. Have a nice day. Look at your excrement.
Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior, totally transcended, expert in all dimensions, knower of all worlds, unsurpassable trainer of those who can be tamed, both teacher and guide, of gods as well as of humans, blessed, exalted, awakened, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the blessed Buddha. Perfectly formulated is this Buddha Dhamma, visible right here and now, immediately effective, timeless, inviting each and everyone to come and see for themselves, inspect, examine, and verify, leading each and everyone through progress towards perfection, directly observable, experienceable, and realizable by each intelligence, perfectly training is this noble Sangha community of the Buddhist noble disciples. They are training the right way, the true way, the good way, the direct way. Therefore, to these eight kind of individuals, these four noble pairs deserve both gifts, self-sacrifice, offerings, hospitality, and reverential salutation, the joint palms. Since this noble Sangha community of the Buddhist noble disciples is an unsurpassable and indeed forever unsurpassed field of merit in this world, for this world, to honor, respect, support, uphold,